you hear me, Carl?
I can hear you, yeah.
And I can see you. And you got a drum kit behind you, like I am.
Oh, very cool.
I'll go and play your drums. You can play mine.
Deal.
How you doing, mate?
Good. Thanks for doing this.
Oh, it's my pleasure. We've been speaking for a long time. And God, your room is very much like mine. Yeah, I think you're in my room and I'm in yours. This is weird.
I had to go in the basement. That's the only place my wife would let me set up all this cacophony.
Well, it's a man cave, isn't it? You know, right. And this is my garage. This is where I did most of the recording, you know, all through the years. So I've moved my Pro Tools into the living room, but we're still using all the analog gear and going through this room and then pumping out the Pro Tools in another room, you know. And I don't have a wife to give me trouble. I don't
like but she'll probably watch this, so it's not that much trouble, dear. cool. So, yeah, I just wanted to, I don't know, as a fan, you know, I own everything you've done. You've co-written so many things. I have all of that. You know, it's so. I just wanted to ask you questions from a fan's perspective on certain songs.
I appreciate your support, Kyle, over the years. That's been fantastic. I know that when you write to me on Facebook and everything, I can tell that you know my songs better than I do. and that's frightening. Oh, actually, I'm going to have to call you sometimes if I go on the road again and say, what are the chords?
Yeah.
What are the chords to these songs?
And interesting, I was listening to an interview, or it might have been on your Owlsnest podcast, that you can't read music. Is that true?
It's true. Yeah, I can't read music. I tried. It's funny, I just did a piece about John Entwistle, you know, the bass player with The Who, who I think is really underrated. And I was reading his book. And I think it was early 80s that I decided to read the bass clef. So I got out Quadrophenia, the Real Me song, and I scored that out, which was one of the worst songs you should ever try and score out because he never stops playing. And and I started to get into it. I really started to get into just the bass clef because I was doing sessions in London as a bass player. And I thought I'd better learn to get the idea, how to look at a page and it not just to be like spiders walking across the page. But I gave in. I was pathetic. And just like Paul McCartney, I just thought, well, if you just play the chords and you sing, you know, and in some ways, I think it... You know, it's strange to say, I wish I did read music, but I think sometimes the less you know, and it's all instinctive, because I learned from records, you know, I learned from, I'm sure you do, from, you know, listening to a recording. So I learned so much from my ears, so that it's concentrating so much on sound. I think that allowed me to write some songs that weren't methodical.
Yeah, it probably... Yeah, it would probably cage you as a songwriter, because you're always then thinking, well, where's this supposed to go? Whereas if you don't, you know, if you're focusing on the theory aspect of it.
It's very true. You know, when I was working with Maurice White in Earth, Wind and Fire, I felt very lucky that we were in the rooms with Maurice, because he'd been with David Foster, and David Foster was such a wonderful keyboard player and an all-rounder. And Maurice White said to me that David Foster used to say to him, that note you're singing, Maurice, is not in the chord. And Maurice would say, but it sounds good.
Right.
And so I think in a lot of ways, you know, instinct helps you go over the lines of what, as you pointed out, I think sometimes I've been with songwriters and they go, well, it should go here. And it should go there, you know, we'll go from G to D. And you go like, well, what? Yeah, but it doesn't feel so good. So I think another big word is feel.
Okay. Yeah.
That's my excuse for not reading music anyway.
Cool. So just a little background for our audience. So you were born in England. And you
formed... Can you tell?
I was trying
to be a Yank and I never got away. I didn't get away with it.
it takes a lot of practice. And But then you formed Q Feel when you were 21. Is that true?
God, you know, I'm not sure about the age. I suppose you're probably right there, you know, because I didn't start early. I started playing bass guitar really at the age of 17 to 18, seriously. So I was very late. I was playing soccer, playing football in Southampton in England. Mm-hmm. And around 21, 22 years old, probably we formed Q Feel, myself and a Scottish guitarist called Brian Fairweather, yeah, in London.
And so that's what ultimately, I have the original vinyl right
oh
here.
Oh my God, my God, did you get that on eBay?
Yes.
So. So you're the one who's bought our second copy.
The copy, it's been there for years, and I was like, yes, I have to have it.
Yes. Yeah, that's right.
But so that was this the record that brought you to America, so to speak?
Yeah, it was, Kyle. It was, because Dancing in Heaven was a huge success here in Los Angeles and really nowhere else. It really exploded in LA when there was a radio station here called K-Rock. And K-Rock was playing all the alternate music. And we seemed to fit into that mode then, which was Flock of Seagulls, Thompson Twins, Ultravox, and Tom Dolby. Mm-hmm. So it was a very big dance record, but it didn't really go into the American charts. People think it was a big hit, but it never got really past, I think, 105. But in the dance charts, it was like top 20. And so it was one of those records which people remember and really sort of think was a big hit, but it was an underground hit. But you're right. Dancing in Heaven brought me to LA, and a lot of the record companies that were working with artists in America at that time in the 80s, trying to change their sound, they all thought that the Q Feel record and Dancing in Heaven, whoever made that record, we'd love those guys to produce Kim Carnes, to work with older artists like the Commodores, Earth, Wind & Fire, try to make their sound different. So I came at the right time in the 80s, and that song was a passport. It was an absolute passport. Actually, it was a passport to one of my favorite bands, Earth, Wind & Fire. I mean, Maurice White had heard it. He wasn't a huge fan of it, but he felt the energy of it. And he said, I'd like to incorporate that energy, young spirit into the sound of Earth, Wind & Fire. So it really was a passport song.
And it has the greatest music video of all time.
I'm leaving now. Bye-bye. Actually, there is no video for that. I mean, there never was a video made for it. That was a one-off live performance in front of for the Eurovision Song Contest back in England. We were very upset that Jive Records didn't realize that this record in America needed a video. Somehow they convinced myself and my partner to make to go into the Eurovision Song Contest, and we did that live, and somehow that video got out, you know. And I've got used to it, but when my friends first said, oh yeah, you wrote In the House of Stone and Light and all these other songs, and now they're going to see you years back look dressed up as a American footballer, and I'm sucking in all this oxygen, pretending to be taking drugs and everything, because we thought the Eurovision Song Contest was very outdated. So when we agreed to do it, we said, we're going to be like the Tubes. We want to be like Fee Waybill and have a couple of sexy girls and really explode it. You know, if we're going to do it, we're going to just go over the top. And what was scary was we were on the Eurovision Song Contest, you have different parts of England voting in on the performances. And two areas, I think Scotland and my side of the country, Southampton, gave us 10 points, 10 out of 10. So in the second round, we were like, oh my God, we're going to win. We didn't plan for this. And then after that, it was a continual dive. We went, nobody voted for us. And we ended up, I think, second from bottom, which for us was like, okay, because we wanted to be an independent band. And we thought if we, if you win the Eurovision Song Contest, you become like ABBA or Bardo, you become a pop band. I mean, it's luring. It's lovely to have a hit song, but we thought we're really not quite that. But so to answer your story there's not really a video for Q-Phil. That's an embarrassing mistake that's out there.
I see. Okay. Because my favorite song on that album is Heroes Never Die.
Yes.
There is a music video for that where you're in the plane acting out, you know, all sorts of things.
I'm not acting too well, but I'm in the plane.
You're in the plane. Yeah. But part of your songwriting that I love personally is especially on that song, it's the moment before you get to the chorus. And I can tell in your songs it's just as important as the chorus. So like, I'll just use We Built This City, for example. That whole section, Marconi plays the mamba, that section there. I think that's more exciting than the actual we built the city over and over again. And then I was listening to the demo, and you actually were using that as your chorus in the demo.
Absolutely. You're ever so perceptive, Carl. That is really good perception, because when I finished the demo, that was the chorus. Marconi plays the mamba, listen to the radio. And I thought, that's, again, Tom Dolby, atmospheric. And I think what you're pointing towards there in Heroes Never Die is emotion, atmosphere. Because even though these are pop songs, if you listen, if you break down Heroes Never Die and play the chords, it's like a hymn. Mm-hmm. And it's beautiful. I feel like it's harmonically emotional. So I finished the demo, gave it to Bernie, and that demo is circulating out there. And Bernie Taupin, Elton's lyricist, who I wrote it with, he just felt like, great, it feels terrific. You know, we're moving into the future. And then, as you say, Starship made it a huge hit by bringing that chorus in. But that, you know, I think what I always look for in writing songs is, even if it's going to be commercial, I really hope that there's a sense of emotion. I mean, that's the best word I can think about. And also dynamic. So as you say, before Heroes Never Die happens, before the chorus comes, before Marconi plays the mamba, I'm looking for people to be grooving and feeling good, but just going like, oh, something in my heart is touching me there. And all the artists I loved as a kid, they seem to do that. You know, they seem to actually have records where they would be pop records that were huge hits, but I just think just behind the first front layer of commerciality is beautiful chords or a great chord progression. And getting back to your question early on, saying that I don't read music, Because if I used to buy all the chord books of all the artists. I've still got them. So what I would do is just open an Elton John chord book, play Goodbye Olympic Road, play it, and then halfway before finishing the song, I'd be making the chords fit a song for me. And then I would learn how, by instinct, that bass notes, not playing the roots, but playing fifths and thirds and giving you a kind of Bach Mozart feeling that there's another layer going on. You see that a lot in these dreams. I started to feel like I was writing songs that had subliminal emotion, you know. So even in Dancing in Heaven, the chord, you know, even we were joking about it, but when you hit the chorus, you know, it's an A flat major seventh going to a B flat, and you get a real sense with that major seventh that you're flying off into space. You just got to play those two chords on a piano, and you go, the major seventh is breaking it into an orchestral emotional place. So for me, I think chords are everything.
Yeah. And then you quickly mentioned these dreams. So I live out here on Cape Cod, and I'm a music director at a church. That's what I do.
Wow.
Yeah. So I play piano and organ.
Is that why you're wearing the white t-shirt? Is that something to do with it?
Yeah. I couldn't find my priest outfit.
I'm very irreverent. You just have to know that.
I usually have to wear a suit all the time. This is very rare.
I can understand. I mean, when you're playing the drums on Healing Waters, you're wearing your baseball hat. I thought, that's not a priest. No,
I'm not a priest.
I'm not a priest.
But so there's a choir there that I, you know, that I direct, and so naturally when I'm listening to things, I'm, much to the chagrin of my friends, I'm analyzing any kind of piece of music that I'm listening to. You know,
I can tell, yeah.
And then, so these dreams by heart, you know, the song you wrote for Hearts, it's very choral in where the voices are going. It's all over the place. And then I remember you had said you presented it to Stevie Nicks, right? And
yeah,
she turned it down. Is that,
well, I didn't present it to Stevie Nicks. It was the first two lyrics that Bernie Taupin gave to me when they said, would you like to work with Elton's lyricist, because I was the new kid in town. I said, I'll be thrilled, because I was a huge fan of Goodbye Yellow Brick Road. Mm-hmm. And so Bernie met with me, and he said he'd heard Dancing in Heaven in Q-Phil. And I mean, I don't think it was his favorite thing, but he thought, this is modern and I want to move on. So he wrote two lyrics for me, which were These Dreams and We Built the City. And he faxed them to me. And those were the first two songs I got from him. And so I sat down with the Fostex 8-track and did two demos for him. Now, These Dreams was called Boys in the Mist at first. It was not, and it was written for Stevie Nicks. Stevie Nicks, I think, had asked Bernie Taupin to write a lyric. And he presented it to her as Boys in the Mist. She, for some reason, didn't want to do it. I don't know if she was in the best of health or whatever, but she just sort of gave it back and said no. Then Bernie said, try this, you know, with We Built the City. And I'd only just started to work with Bernie, but when I wrote the song of These Dreams, I knew it was strong straight away. I mean, I wrote it in 10 minutes. It was pretty instant. Other songs have taken forever, but this one came quite quickly. But I just felt like Boys in the Mist wasn't the right title. So I called Bernie and said, do you mind if I put the bridge, These Dreams, in as the chorus? And he said, no, Elton does that all the time. So that demo, as you say, was given to Stevie Nicks. She turned it down. I then presented it to Kim Carnes, because I was working with Kim Carnes, and she loved it. She went in the studio, and I think, again, perception from you, Kyle, she found the range so hard, up and down and all over the place. And so she said, that's too rangy for me. And the story goes, she's turned down three number ones in a row, and this was the third one she turned down. So she called me and said, I can't believe it. I turned down These Dreams, and now it's gone number one. I'm known for that. So Kim Carnes started to get a reputation that if you turned a song down, it was going to be number one, without a doubt. But you're right. I think in House of Stone and Light as well, my own song, In Shape the Invisible, which you played the drums to on that great video, it's choral. I grew up in England, in the English churches. So I'm not religious, I'm spiritual, but I absolutely loved going into churches and cathedrals and hearing choirs sing. So I still feel really strong when I write a song even now that I'm listening to choral music, and that chords, you know, the how chords are made up are and the voicings of them are so emotional. So I did grow up in England where we were forced to go to churches and hear all the Taverner and hear all the bird hymns. And it really stuck with me. I just thought that was the most glorious music. So I think, like, you hear that in Sting, you hear that in Peter Gabriel, and my childhood was very much that way, where we were in Genesis, where you're brought into church as early as kids. So my writing, I think, does show a lot of that. You're right, absolutely right, yes. Choral work in my songs, yeah.
So speaking of Genesis, Selling England is one of your favorites.
Ah. Ever. Good gracious. Yes.
I'm a Genesis freak, so we could go on hours just talking about
that. Let's do another podcast about
yeah,
that.
Yeah. We'd have to do it in volumes.
Nursery crime. Oh, musical yeah. box. Oh my god. Yeah.
Yeah. So from the success of We Built the City and Heart, you and Bernie did this.
Ah, Tribe. Yeah.
Tribe. Which is essentially a Martin Page album, because you co-wrote every song on the record, right?
Yeah, I've got all the demos of me singing it, so I've got another version of that album.
Okay,
yeah.
So send those to me when we're done here. So
it'll cost you $732 $0.52. Okay? Okay,
as long as it's not euros, exchange rate. So was that? Did you guys decide because of the success of those two songs, let's do an album together? Is that?
It was Bernie's idea. I mean, I was a new kid in town, so, you know, Bernie was leading the way, really. But yes, I know that he said in a couple of interviews that the moment our first two songs went number one, we just thought we're onto something good here. And Bernie, I've written maybe with Bernie. I just realized now when I was doing my radio podcast shows, because I look for the old demos, I must have written with Bernie something like about 500 songs. And we just had a flow. He wasn't with Elton John quite at that period. They were separated, in the sense that Bernie was not doing much and Elton was working with another lyricist. So I caught Bernie at the right time. And of course, I'm quite proud, really, that, you know, Elton's never had a number one with anybody else, but Bernie's had number one with me. And I felt very proud that Bernie trusted me. That was the huge thing for me, that Bernie said to me early on, you know, you're as addicted as Elton was, you know, you're thousands of records, you know everything, you can't stop doing it. And so he said Elton was the same. So we really got on. And Bernie just called me up one day and said, I've made a couple of records and they haven't been good, and I want to make another one, and I think you should produce it. And he sent me, I think, 12 songs, again on the fax. And I wrote the songs in 3 weeks, very quick. Went to his house, played it to him. Then he came to my little house on Crescent Heights in LA, and I taught him the songs, melodies. And we worked on his voice for a long time. And the lyrics were great. I mean, Corrugated Iron.
That sounds so cool. It's so unique, that Corrugated Iron.
Corrugated Iron is my favorite song.
In the heart of Johannesburg. And we live it, and we live on.
Because Bill Bottrell mixed that, and there was such a power in that in that track. So there was some, and one of my favorite songs always, when people ask me what I've written, I would say Desperation Train was a beautiful, beautiful lyric from Bernie, pretty outstanding. Yeah, so Bernie asked me to do it. We did it. We didn't have any success, although I think Citizen Jane got into the American AC chart. So Bernie charted for the first time. And what was great, actually, Carl, was that Elton came in to sing a couple of songs, Billy Fury, based on a 60s pop star from England, and Elton sang on Citizen Jane. So it was a great, great experience.
Mm-hmm. Cool. All right. So I have a couple of songs that I just want to ask you deep dive questions for
Okay. But so, you know all the answers because you know the chords, you know the melodies, you've written them out.
Yeah, but it's fun hearing you talk about it. Nobody wants to hear me talk about it. But in your podcast, which is the people watching this, it's called Radio Owlsnest. You must listen to it if you like Martin at all. It's all things Martin Page. And it's the information is coming at you like rapid fire on this thing. But my wife and I would listen to it in the car and she'd have to pause it and go, you got to explain some of this stuff. He's going too fast.
It's because of my accent, my O-R from the south of England. O-R. Yeah. But tell your wife, I'm pleased that she at least wants to go back and play it again. That's pretty good.
But I wasn't familiar with that song Count on Me, which which is kind of like your prelude into In the House of Stone and Light, because I heard you talk about that was the first song that you felt so strongly about your vocal that, right, the record company wanted I forget who it was, Lou Gramm?
Lou Gramm, a Foreigner, yeah.
To sing it, and you said, no, I want to do this.
A sign of hope. Oh, when you reached out for my hand, you can always count on me. Wherever you go is where I'll be.
That's the truth. I think that Count on Me, you know, could have been on one of my albums. It was just that I had a... When I made In the House of Stone and Light, I think I was making it at a mature age. And I'd just been working with Robbie Robertson from the band on his solo album. So we'd written Fallen Angel, Peter Gabriel had sung it, Daniel Lemoyne was involved. And I just thought, this is what I want to do. I want to do something that has great emotion in it. I'm an older guy now. I mean, I made House of Stone and Light at a late stage again. Count on Me was, as you pointed out, just before I did House of Stone and Light. And I just felt like my voice was just beginning to become real to me. I was really caring about how I presented. And I'm jumping back here again. I saw myself a bit like Trevor Horn, you know, where I knew all the artists, like you're a fanatic. I knew everybody who was going to work with me. So if I worked with them, I understood the vocalists. But I had the greatest vocalists working around me, Philip Bailey, Earth, Wind & Fire, Maurice White. We had Go West, Pete Cox, Paul Young from England. So all the great vocalists, Tom Jones, you know, I was producing these guys. And of course, I'd be in this room and Tom Jones would be singing. And I'd be like going, oh, my God, you know, the standard, Elton John, you know, I was working with them. Mm-hmm. And then what happened was that when I was working on the Robbie Robertson solo album, I would bring up my demos for the Fallen Angel and How's Half Acre. And it was me singing them in here for him to hear. And he'd say, there's something in your voice. You've really got an emotion. You know, you why aren't you making a solo record? So, and my manager, Diane Pontru, who'd been with me for many years. She just said, there's going to be a time when you want to make your own record. So Count on Me. Felt when I made that song for a movie, Gladiator, a boxing movie, and then everybody started to say it was such a great vocal, it's such a passionate song. Mick Gazowski was a great engineer that I'd met with Earth, Wind & Fire. He mixed it, and when I heard the mix, I just thought, I sound pretty good. I sound like this is I sound quite real here. And then the actual film people said. I'm going too fast here. The film people said, what a great song. We love it. It's perfect for the film, but we want a superstar to sing it, and that'll be Lou Gramm. And my manager just said, it's time for you're just about to make House of Stone and Light. It's time for you to say no, and let's put, and if they want the song, and of course you take a risk then, because the film people will go like, yeah, you know, who's Martin Page? But they went for it because the song was so strong. So that was just before In the House of Stone and Light. And I think, as you've just pointed out there, I didn't notice it at the time, because I think in the early years, Kyle, you're so precious about what you release and what you do. Now, you know, here I am in the later years putting out Radio Owlsnest and playing all the demos, all the roughs, everything, and just feeling good about hearing how things are have developed. But Count On Me was really a prelude to In the House of Stone and Light. And I think then I was singing at a very, suddenly my range lifted up. I was singing higher than I could even, you know, conceive. You know, I would listen back to the tracks and go, no wonder Mickey Thomas of Starship was cutting my songs because he sings up there.
Yeah.
And I was as well. And I'm like, I can see it now. You know, I mean, doing the Radio Owlsnest shows, when I listen to the demos, like, I can see why the high singers are doing my demos because I'm singing very, very high at times. You know, now in my later years, I'm down here because the octaves have dropped. Now I'm singing much lower. But Count On Me, yes. And a lot of my fans have sort of recognized that that was the real prelude to In the House of Stone and Light.
Okay. So did you
have... You're right again.
Yeah,
again,
yeah.
You're right. Get something wrong.
I can't. So you had In the House of Stone and Light ready to go at that point? Like the songs?
Yes. I mean, people might think that, that came after, but I was working on In the House of Stone and Light, and Light in Your Heart from the album had got Mercury Records involved, and I had a lot of the songs being built. So yeah, the album was happening at that time.
Wow.
Okay. You didn't know that.
I did not know that.
I could see that.
When I go quiet, that usually means I'm...
Yeah, I could see it. I could see you in front of your choir going, I don't know what to do now. I could see it. I don't know what to do. Yeah. Hey, I want to hear your choir sing These Dreams.
So, oh, yeah. Okay.
You have to arrange that. I'd love to hear that.
Okay.
We've always talked about, a manager and I, that These Dreams chorally would be, I mean, everybody does In the House of Stone and Light. I mean, there's thousands of choirs doing that, which is wonderful. But These Dreams, I don't think people, if you look into the body of it, I think it'd be brilliant for a choir.
Okay, yeah. I do.
I'm putting pressure on you now.
Yeah, I know you are, but it's okay. It's a labor of love.
You've got a week.
Okay.
That's what I used to get from film companies. You've got a week, maybe 3 days now. Get it done.
I do a November concert at the church every year, and I invite the community, not just the parishioners, and we tend to do contemporary type things in the church.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I was working on an arrangement of Fragile by Sting.
That's beautiful
for the choir, because I figured it's that we couldn't do it last year because of the pandemic, so you know I was like, oh, maybe this might be nice to start the show. The lyrics are, you know,
it's one of the most beautiful songs he's written, with Fields of Gold. Absolutely.
Yeah.
But I still think you have to do These Dreams, because I've just told you should.
I will.
Hey, I've got to ask you, Carl, I just got to ask you, because you're such an accomplished drummer. I mean, you don't drum with bands or anything. How did that happen that you're such, you know, I mean, you're a drummer.
Yeah, so I'm a trained piano player since I was five.
Wow.
But it's literally Phil Collins watching him drum. He was left-handed and I'm left-handed, and I play open, so
yes.
But I was able
to... on my new album I'm doing now, I've got to jump in here, Trevor Thorne from my band Q-Phil, because Jimmy Copley passed away, he's been playing with me constantly, and he's the same thing, open left hand.
Yeah.
And when I sent your video to him, he went like, oh, open left hand, cool. Yeah. You know, it was great.
Some people go, that's weird. How are you doing that?
No, it feels natural. It looks natural to me.
Just feels natural. Because he was left-handed and is left-handed, I was able to just mimic him, because when you watch his drum kit, which is left, it mirrors, you know, when you're watching it on. So I just got used to the sound of the Genesis records. My parents had them when I was very young, you know, on the shelf. Yeah. I would listen to the CDs, and I just got used to that sound.
I think Phil Collins, you know, I know we're jumping off here, it's your show, but I went to see them play Selling England by the Pound live in Southampton, I think in the 70s at the Gaumont. And I stayed up all night just waiting to get a ticket. And it's when Peter Gabriel was levitating and everything. And I was watching Phil Collins continually. I mean, it's amazing that he worked with me because I just knew him. And I knew how, I thought he was the most funky progressive drummer. Yeah, there was Bruford.
Yeah.
And he was funky, but you had such a melodic, funky drummer, which understood how Ringo played as well. And I think if you listen to the early records by Genesis, what is the track that's in 6/8 or 6/9 or 9/11? What is
that 9/8 section in Supper's Ready when he's...
I picked up the bass about a year ago and played along to the end of that, and it was like my brain had to focus.
I don't understand how they did it live, because you have to stay so focused, whatever instrument you're playing, and they just let Phil go off. And
he was going all over the place,
yeah,
and still coming back. And I asked him about it when he was playing. I said, how about all these time signatures, Phil? Because when he was playing my album, it was like, it's going to be in 4/4. There's no problem here. And he said, I felt it. I didn't really read it or write it. We rehearsed so much. I just felt it.
Yeah, I read he always wanted Tony Banks next to him on the keys, because whenever he felt lost, he would watch Tony's fingers and he would get used to what keyboard he was using at certain times and to know.
How interesting. Because Tony Banks on that, I know we're going into progressive rock here. He's playing in 4/4.
Right.
I mean, a lot of those riffs are 4/4 riffs, and that's what confuses us because we're following the keyboard. But then when we listen to Rutherford and the drums, you go like, my God, that's another world altogether. You know,
it's almost like Phil's limbs are in complete independence of each other at the same time. Yeah. But it's like,
I've got to say to you that when he played on I Was Made For You and Lighten Your Heart in the studio, we hadn't had tremendous success with that song with Jimmy. I'd recorded it with Jimmy, but we needed another outlook on it. And Phil is a musical drummer like Ringo. So he's like, let me play the toms on I Was Made For You. Then I'll put the snare on after. Mm-hmm. And he's a songwriter. So that's the thing, what you get from Phil Collins is he's listening to the song. So he plays the drums like a songwriter. That's the big difference, what you get with him.
Yeah, his dynamics are crazy. I mean, those early records, you can hear those ghost notes on the snare drum, like if you're really listening, and that makes his sound. But like I told you, I could talk Genesis.
No, I know, we're leading off, and I got excited there. So I thought, this is a Genesis podcast. I'm going to go on for days.
But, his tom drumming on your In the House of Stone and Light, on Shape the Invisible,
He only plays the toms, right?
And then that song, I want to ask you about that song, because
you played that great on your video.
Thanks.
I wish Jimmy could have seen it. You know, I know Jimmy would have got off on seeing you play that.
You know, it's funny, and this isn't me patting myself on the back, but that was my first take. It's because I've listened to that song so many times. Is that I just know? It's just you're such a foundation in my music.
Thank you, Carl. I say Phil Collins played on that as well, and he listened to Jimmy playing. You know how the kick is different on that. It's a whole different vibe because Jimmy Copley was probably like you, where he listened to my drum program and he said, I'm going to emulate that drum program as close as I can. He did that with Tears for Fears. So when Phil Collins was playing on my record, I played him Shape the Invisible and said, this is Jimmy Copley playing it. And he goes, oh, I'm a fan of Jimmy's. I used to know Jimmy's dad, and his dad was a gangster. So no wonder Phil knew him. So he listened to it and he said, I can't emulate what Jimmy's playing. He said, I play Shape the Invisible, but I'm going to have to power through it. I'm not going to do all these kicks off the beat and everything. So we've got a version of Phil Collins playing Shape the Invisible, and it sounds like Turn On Your Radio, you know?
Okay, yeah.
Going, like, just steaming through it. And I had to make a real decision at the end of the record to say, do I want that steaming through, or do we want this very interesting kick drum pattern, which I programmed, and we went for Jimmy, but we used some of Phil's toms on top of it. Phil Collins has just played all that 12, 8, and 16, 9, all these rhythms, and he heard Phil Collins and what you played on Shape the Invisible, and he said, I can't do that. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to power through it. So you know it's from feel. You know what I mean?
So I read when you were talking about who was the painter that said his job is to shape the invisible, right?
Leonardo da Vinci.
Da Vinci,
yeah.
So is that meaning making something out of nothing? Is that what you're getting? What's the theme of that song lyrically?
Well, in the Shape the Invisible, each verse relates to when I wrote the song, some aspects in the world which were, you know, awful. The war that was going on in Ireland and the troubles there. And I just felt like we're always talking about getting peace. We're always talking about getting it right. But we never seem to, you know, in one of the verses is about that era when I was writing the song. I'm sure we know we're dealing with that, but there's kids being shot on the street in Los Angeles, you know, drive-by shootings. And yet we go like, okay, let's just shed some tears and pray and off we go again. And we'll get control of the guns. So I just thought is that when I read Da Vinci's life, he just said art is shaping the invisible. You know, it is, as you pointed out, we are creating something out of nothing. And so I just thought it's really like, I wish we could do that with the aspect of our human characters, that we didn't have to go to war all the time. I wish we could not just creativity, but just think we can shape the invisible. We don't have to carry guns. We don't have to go to war. We don't have to do this or do that. And in the last verse, I just, you know, in the positive aspects, I'm quite a pessimistic person, but I just thought one day, you know, a child will be born, who will shape the invisible, which will turn our heads around. And we have to think of youth, and we have to think of making our children understand that this hasn't got to be a routine and so cyclical. So Shape the Invisible is a very positive song. And I am a pessimist deeply, but I just felt like when you do music, when you play the drums, when you write, when you're with your choir, there's such a feeling of anything can be achieved. And yet in real life, sometimes we're already shut up in our little, you can't shape the invisible. This is the way it's got to be. It's got to be. So that was just but you are right. The instinct came from Da Vinci just saying, when I paint, I create something out of nothing. It is shaping the invisible. And I just thought, well, let's shape the invisible into something positive.
Yeah, you mentioned the line at the end about the boy.
Somewhere a small boy is playing with his toys. Someday his innocence will shape the invisible.
It's such a heavy song, and then at the end, you have this image, you know, the boy's playing with his toys, like you said, and someday he'll shape the invisible. Yeah. It's that you don't know what he's going to do to change, you know, to change the world or have some kind of impact on the world. And then, of course, it sounds like there's just a drum battle between Jimmy and Phil to fade out the song. You know, you get the classic Tom Phil. Fantastic stuff.
Thank you.
So one more song I want to ask you about. The title track of that record, In the House of Stone and Light, I had the lyric wrong, which makes absolutely no sense. At the very end, when you say the Havasupai Shaman, Let Me Be Reborn. I used to always think you said, have a soup of shame and let me be reborn.
It's been too long, my spirit's been at war. Have a soup of shame and let me be reborn. And I will embrace.
I did. That is the lyric.
Oh, it is.
That is the lyric, yes. Have a soup by shame is what somebody else said it was, but have some soup is what I really felt. You don't believe me, do you?
I don't know. Maybe after this, I might.
You know, I had the same thing with Dancing in Heaven when we go Orbital Bebop. Everybody was sort of saying, you know, oh, you bit a dog off or something. I mean, it was like... And so have a supai shaman is not really the kind of lyrics you would see in a pop song. I mean, you know, have a supai, I don't think has ever been used before, but I can see why you thought it was a bowl of soup. I can grasp that.
Makes no sense upon reflecting about it.
You probably thought in the House of Stone and Light, they've got really great Heinz bean soup. That's what definitely, you think.
That's right. Definitely not Campbell's. I researched it and I had no idea there was this city at the bottom of the Grand Canyon.
Well, it's not really a city. It's a ranch where the Indians, the Havasupai, are. And I went to the Grand Canyon to get a break from all the hard work I was doing. I was becoming really, you know, in here like you are down in your man cave. I was never leaving. I was just one project after another. And so I went to the Grand Canyon for 2 weeks. And it was really, you know, it sounds like a cliche, but it was soul changing. And my manager who went with me said, this is going to be good for you. And she said, you know, we're going to take a helicopter ride down into the canyon. And I was like, oh dear. Oh, oh my God. And it was, you know, it was hairy. I mean, it was, you really, it was straight down. And of course it was like 130 degrees in the bottom of the canyon. And that's where the Havasupai live. And so I picked up a little booklet they had there to say, this is the Havasupai tribe. And it was called In the House of Stone and Light. And that's what the Havasupai tribe called their habitat. And I just took that back with me and just thought, what an incredible phrase that is. And to me, because I was worn out in the studios and not very healthy, I just thought that title to me meant my body, the house, is, and I've got to be strong, so I need stone. And light is a positivity, which I'm losing because I'm getting a bit, overdone, overburnt. And so I wasn't seeing positivity so much. So to me, the whole song In the House of Stone and Light was about my body. It was about this is your house of stone and light. You know, how you feel, how you see optimism, and you have to be strong and keep yourself healthy. So it was a very lucky thing. And that does happen to me a lot where I write down phrases and then maybe a year later, I just go, that's such a great title. And I understand now what it's about. So yeah, it came from the Grand Canyon, from that tribe.
Yeah. I was reading that sometimes the helicopters aren't available and you have, it's an 8 mile hike to downhill, I guess.
You're just bringing it back to me. I got so hot down there that I had to get into a river and sort of sit there in all my clothes and just cool down because I thought I'm going to explode. And I remember the helicopter. I mean, my manager, who's much more into thrills and spills, she said, let's do it again. I'm going, no, never. And the helicopter pilot did say, if you don't get back, because when he dropped us off, he said, if you don't get back by 5:30 or something, we don't come back again and you'll have to stay here. Okay. And so it was a race about 4 o'clock while I'm sweating like a pig through the river going, gotta get to the helicopter. And I'm thinking, and these Indians are looking at me going like, oh yeah, another white man down here dying a death, totally out of control. And it was thrilling, of course, for your spirit, but the helicopter, you know, going over the edge of the canyon and going down, you're like, oh my God, forgive me for saying this, my testicles are in my ears. And and then when we lifted up, there was all this turbulence going back up. And of course you have those memories, you think, oh, I'm another rocker. I'm another songwriter who's going to die in the Grand Canyon. this is it. I'm not even gonna get a chance to write about House of Stone and Light, but A fantastic thing for me to do. And so thrilled that my manager said, be a man, be brave, go down, get heat stroke, and try and negotiate with an Indian tribe.
Then so, get the t-shirt on your way out.
No, mate, I just want to just get out. You know, as soon as I saw the pilot, I was going, I love you. Thank you. Take me home. So, and then I came back, and in this studio here, I wrote the song, and we did the album. I have to say again that it was because I wrote with Robbie Robertson and did his solo record with Fallen Angel that I felt like I was inspired to, at that late stage, make that record.
Cool. So what are you doing now? Was I reading that you have a new album you're working on with a band, like full band?
Yeah, it's
should we not talk about this yet? Do you want to?
No, it's great. It's just, I've been on this for about 5 years, and it is, again, what we're talking about, In the House of Stone and Light, all the musicians that played on that record have come back to work on this record called The First and Last Freedom. And, you know, every songwriter says the next thing he's doing is the most, fantastic. But this has been all the players that came on that record, came back again, fortunately. I mean, at first, Jimmy Copley had leukemia, the drummer, and I reached out to him and said, you know, I want to fly you over and let's do it one more time. And he said, have you got any songs? And I said, yeah. And all I was thinking about was being with Jimmy one more time because he had this disease. And I wrote 4 or 5 songs that I thought he could play on. His girlfriend in England said, send it to him at the hospital because it'll lift him. So I sent him these songs and he called me and said, these are so special, Pagey. This is going to get me out of the hospital. And he sent me a video when he got out of hospital playing Shake the Invisible again, him just at home. It's on my website. If you look deeply at it, he said, I'm back. He's doing what you're doing. Because that was one of his favorite songs to play. Unfortunately, he never recovered. But at that same time, as I was writing these 5 songs to get Jimmy involved, Jack Hughes from Wang Chung, who was a friend of mine, he lost his wife to cancer and he was in LA. And I said, come across and jam with me. And I wrote a couple of songs for him to play on. Then Neil Taylor, who played on House of Stone and Light, Tears for Fears guitarist, Jimmy Copley's best friend, he was in town playing and he came in. And then I thought, well, what? This is really building into something special. And that every player that played on this, even though it was made just to get people together, said, this is the best material we've ever heard from you. It's just brilliant to play on. And Jack Hughes said, you know, you've gone beyond everything you've done before. I think because, again, it was a spiritual record, The First and Last Freedom. And I saw the title as, you know, the first thing that made me free was music. And the last thing that made me free is music. This is your first and last freedom of everything you do. Sounds very grand, but I really connected with that. Then I thought, I'll reach out to the Blue Nile, Paul Joseph Moore, the keyboardist in Glasgow. And I sent him the tracks and he played some amazing keyboards like he did on Put On Your Red Dress, Shake the Invisible. He sent them back. And then Bill Dylan, the Canadian guitarist who played with me on Robbie Robertson and played on In Your Room and all the tracks on House. He did some work. And then I thought, I'm going to put some horns on one of these tracks. So I got a horn section from LA, one of the best horn sets. And all of a sudden I thought, oh my God, I've got a massive record here. How the F do I mix this? This is hard. This is going to be, the songs are so strong. My manager said, this is the best stuff you've ever done at your late age in your career. So I spent 2 years mixing it and I finished the final mix 3 weeks ago after 2 years. So it's there. And of course you want to put it out the right way. And because of COVID and not being able to put out CDs, there's nobody here making CDs. And I like to oversee the mastering and everything. We're going to put it out next year when I can really do it the right way, because it deserves to be that way. I know everybody says, oh, this is the best work I've ever done, but everybody around me, even though I'm an older man who goes, yeah, 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 they're all saying this is of another level. So I do believe it is. I believe it's the best work I've done since House of Stone and Light, consistent spiritual work with those players. And it's, I think what happened, Kyle, as well, is I'm so used to making records on my own, like Todd Rundgren, Stevie Wonder, I do everything myself. To have all the players around me, I just suddenly went like, oh my God, my music expands into another place. So we're going to put that out next year. But in between that, I put out Fugitive Pieces, which is a very intimate record, just me at the piano. And that came over a period of 3 weeks of just beating a depression and putting music down to keep me healthy. And that's done very well for me. And I'm very pleased of that. And we've got an instrumental record, my second instrumental record called The Occupation of Hope, that we're hopefully going to put out in October and November. That's the plan. You got to put out as much as you can these days before you do that. Because that could be me next week. So right. We have to get the music out, you know?
That's the guy that didn't make the helicopter.
I look at that every day and go, make another record quick.
I guess that's a good inspiration. I don't know.
Yeah, I've got a few skulls around the house. Okay, get it going.
Just to remind you. I won't take up too much more of your time.
Oh, it's okay.
Is there a songwriter that you haven't worked with that you'd love to just be in a room with?
Yeah, there is. There's quite a few, you know, because that era that I was working with everybody, and most people I worked with, I'd studied, I'd had all their albums. I'm just like you, if I was going to work with Go West, I already had their albums. I had Dancing on the Couch. So when they came to me, I knew everything about them. I was a fanatic, vinyl fanatic. I bought everything. So an artist I really, really wish I'd written with was Boss Skaggs. Oh, I really felt like, yeah, I loved Middleman, and I loved when he was with Toto. Mm-hmm. And I would have liked to have written with Boss Skaggs. I think we would have connected real well, because when I worked with Paul Young in that Blue Eyed Soul, I just thought I'd love to work with Boss. And at the same time, I'd like to have bumped into, although I was in the studio with Steve Lukather a few times with Maurice White, I'd like to have sat down with David Paich and Steve Lukather from Toto. And James Taylor, I would have liked to have bumped into. And, you know, I just think it's to do with characters, you know, and how you are. I think Diane said if John Lennon had lived on, I think I would have had a good laugh with him and sat in a room. And of course, Peter Gabriel, although he sang on Fallen Angel, I had met him a few times and we were supposed to work together, but he was so busy. I would have liked to have, I've written with Peter Gabriel as well. Yeah. Wow. And Arvo Pärt, the classical composer now, who doesn't work with anybody, but I just feel like some of these people, I just like to be around and sense their energy, you know?
Yeah. All right. So is there modern music that you listen to now?
I'm not too up on modern music. I'll be real honest to you. You know, I every now and then listen to the top 10 on iTunes, the top 20, top 30. And I used, when I was really breaking through in the 80s, 90s and 70s, the publisher used to send me all the top 30 and I would really study them. But I think what's happened is you get to my age, and I'm being real serious about this, is that you have to focus on what you're about. To me, even though I was having hits like Diane Warren and Desmond Child, I felt like I could fall into that machine, that constant thing that is where people come to you and you change your style for them. And I felt like I had a voice, and I felt like I would like to do what these last 10 years have been like, is really express myself. Because I found that when I was writing these hits, which we all love to have, there's no doubt about it. I've been very lucky. These Dreams and We Built the City have been, King Wishful Thinking, have been big songs for me, and they've allowed me to be free. I used to, like you with Genesis, I just thought, I wish I was working in a, you know, doing more artistic outside the box work, because I came from a bass player's aspect. I was into Jethro Tull. I was into Van de Graaff Generator. I was into this stuff. And I was also into pop. So I feel like why I'm not quite oriented towards what's happening pop-wise now is because I'm really trying to find out what's in me before you kick the bucket, before, you know, you're talking to him, you know, what's it all about? So I do feel like it's great to keep in touch, but you've also got to realize, I think, and I hope I'm not stretching this out too much, but when you write Dancing in Heaven as an 80s pop band, you did it then, culture saw it, you felt it, you were that. I couldn't do Dancing in Heaven again now. When I wrote House of Stone and Light, it was the time, it was the 90s, it was what was happening, Hootie the Blowfish, Melissa Etheridge, all live players. When I do what I'm writing now is about me now. It's not, and I also feel like you have to be very aware that you're not going to be here for another 30 years, because when you, when we were break, when I was breaking, you knew that, you know, the future is there and you can, you got a lot of time. So I don't mean this really pessimistically, but you just go like, whatever energy is there and whatever I'm going to say lyrically or whatever I'm going to say emotionally, I've got to do that more than copy a style or get enveloped in just creating a machine of pop, of pure pop. It's lovely, but I also think I probably wouldn't understand it the best. You know, it's like when Phil Collins had worked with Adele, it was like it didn't happen. It just couldn't, because we're all, you know, you, it's when you are, it's your time, what you're best at doing. That's not to say that I wouldn't love collaborating with somebody who saw the potential in me, but you can't change your styles too much at a certain point. I think you have to be what you are. And to be honest with you, since the, and I'll finish, but since everything went into the digital age, I think a lot of the music is just become very, very plastic and very quick. And, you know, you need to download it. You've got it. You don't have to have any reverence for it. You don't have to live with it. You don't have to look at the lyrics. You don't have to push the cover up. When in the earlier days, music was much more revered, much more special to get. But now, you know, you push a knob and you've got 100 songs. Push a knob, you've got 200 songs. You get Amazon Plus, you've got everything. Even for me, I got Amazon Music Plus and I was like, oh, I was about to buy a CD, but I'm pretty sure I've got it. Mm-hmm. And so I think that digital, I'll be, you know, ending on a really happy note here. I think digital is wonderful for us to edit and move on and great in hospitals. But I do think it's done a huge damage to the reverence of music.
Yeah, and you, like you said, you can't study and soak in an album anymore. It's, you need to have it now. And so I wanted to tell you this in the beginning of the show, and this kind of rolls into what you were just talking about with the reading, you know, reading the album. So it's 1994. I'm 9 years old, okay, and I'm in the car with my mother. She had this green Jeep Cherokee. She had two cassettes. She had Phil's No Jacket Required album, and You're in the House of Stone and Light cassette. And that's all I heard for like...
You poor man.
You starved
as a young man, starved.
Right, but then what I did was I was used to this sound, and then I started reading the liner notes and I went, he plays drums on this too? And then I went, okay, because now I'm like, this is my sound now. So then really from that early age, those two were like defining in my musical. And I've always searched for that kind of sound. So when people go, you know, have you heard this record, you know, new modern things, I'm like, if it wasn't before 1994, I don't know what you're talking about. And they're like, oh, you're so arrogant with, you know, your early music and you don't listen to, you know, computer music now. I'm like, well, you know, it's this.
You know, I try. And I'm sure you do. And if it gets you, it does. I mean, in the period that I was here in LA, you know, Prince was happening and we were signed to his management company and the time and everything. It's ever so exciting. It's just that I think we would know, because we are still musical fanatics. You still got your choir. And I'm still writing all the time and still motivated. I think we would know if we were hearing a Joni Mitchell. I think we would know if we were hearing something that just, we went like when the Beatles happened, you know, you just sort of know, because even now I'll go back and listen to Glenn Miller and listen to early blues and go, it's outstanding. It's outstanding. There's such a reverence for the music. Mm-hmm. And so even there maybe Joni Mitchell's out there now, but it's hard for us to find her. Because there's just so much. And everything is not an album. Where an album was a book, it was a movie. And I don't want to sound like oh, woe me. But really, for a young kid even, I think it's really hard for them to go, oh, listen to Black Dog by Led Zeppelin. Listen to the drums by Bonham. He's playing, you know, he's playing against the a time signature in 4/4, and it's happening. It's not programmed in a bedroom. Nothing wrong with all that. We've all gone through it. We've had to use our drum machines and how to build things. But I think what we lack now is that sense of knowing if something really emotional or unique has really happened, because we're going to go from Billie Eilish into something else. You know, we're going to go from Coldplay to something else. And you even get a feeling with a band like Coldplay that came on and was very much like U2. And there might be a huge substance, great writer. But you do get a feeling that it's all linear and that it's all just being focused at what has to happen at that point. So in our era, and you're young, much younger than me, we might have heard the Beach Boys, we might have heard the Rascals, we might have heard Jefferson Starship, we might have heard the Beatles all at the same time. And then we would hear Funkadelic and Parliament and Sly and the Family Stone. Now there's you listen to the top 10 of iTunes and you go like, I'm not sure the same singer sang on every effing track. I'm just can't, you know, with auto tune and everything. I mean, it's really hooky, it gets you going and it sticks in your head. But you go, I don't feel the artistry of Big Yellow Taxi when Joni Mitchell broke, you know, or Sledgehammer by Peter Gabriel. You just go, something's happening, there's real life in this. And yeah, and so I have a problem actually, because I'm using Pro Tools. I have to go through all my compressors and try to, you know, do the live drums and use the guitars to just try and make it feel like there's some humanity. Because I think, again, you know, I don't want your show to be too long, but I do think that there's humans want to be robots. You know, we really want to end up just being boom, push a button and everything happens. So you can hear that in the music. I don't know, my manager thinks it will swing around again, but you can listen to the top 20 now. And I have done that because I think that, I hope I get sparked up and I hear Spirit in the Sky, you know, by Norman Greenbaum, but different. And I go, oh, that's amazing. But you do get a feeling that you can listen to 10 songs and go, oh, it's all on auto-tune. It's all done in a bedroom. It's all been manipulated. The harmonies have been created on auto-tune as well. And they're using a micro brute drum machine, and you just go like, wow, I know it's pointing at the 80s, but it's definitely speed oriented. That's what I really want to say, Kyle, is it's speed oriented. And when things are speed oriented, you don't get time sometimes to stand back and go, oh my God, that's glorious. There's something like Elgar's symphonies, or, you know, like you said, early Genesis. You know that the work went into Genesis rehearsals. You know that that band had to come together and rehearse for ages to pull that off in the studio. I miss that a little bit. I miss that somebody's not singing through a auto tune and 1,000 effects. And when they had to find harmonies, they'll just push a third, fifth, sixth, seventh. Let's just keep on going up on the keyboard. That'll sound good. And although it's hooky, it sounds to me as though we could be in a spaceship. And even, you know, I was beginning of the techno period with Dancing in Heaven, and we had people in LA going, Q-Feel, synthesizers, Fairlights, Synclaviers, horrible. But even back then in those 80s, you know, you would get George Michael, you would get Depeche Mode, you would get some very interesting, you still had to do your thing. You still had to play, you still had to sing. So I think digital has a lot to answer for. And I don't think it's a really, really great time for pop music. I could be the guy that sits here and goes, oh, I understand pop music. I love the top 10 and I can emulate it and I should be there now. But if you don't feel it, I don't think you can do it. And I think that there's a cosmetic linear line right across the top 20 where you just go, the track that's number 19 could be the track that's number one. And is it the same singer? Maybe I'm missing something, but that's how I feel. Is musical ability has become second to working as a typist on a computer. You know, it's very skillful, very clever, but I still think that humans deep down want to hear humanity in music a little. You know, maybe they don't, maybe they want to be robots, but I do think there's a kind of, we can just get anything we want anytime if we sign up to Spotify and push a button. And I don't think that bodes well for songwriters. We don't make any money from streaming and for musicians in general. You know, it's not great for music, the depth of music. I think it's a bit pretty barren time, but it might turn around. Well, hopefully it will.
Yeah.
I thought I'd end on a really pessimistic, suicidal note, just to lift everybody up at the end of the show.
All right,
there'll be no more music anymore.
I'll close with one more question. What musically or what part of your career are you most proud of looking back?
Oh, that's a great question. Only way I can answer that, Carl, properly without just saying something crap is to say that when I first started playing bass, end of the 70s, 80s, I felt very, very proud of how I played bass. And I thought, I'm learning about music. Then I would say when I wrote Fallen Angel with Robbie Robertson, that I'd come to a certain level of musical artistry. And so those sections feel good to me. Learning bass, playing with Robbie Robertson, These Dreams, just around that time. These Dreams were just before that. Over the edge of that, I'm saying three places. First base, Robbie Robertson, Earth, Wind & Fire, Bernie Taupin, These Dreams. And I would say now, with Fugitive Pieces, I would say that the last record I've made, Fugitive Pieces, which is very much a just me at the piano and thinking about my childhood, how depression affected me and how music had healed me. I think I wrote Fugitive Pieces. I think Fugitive Pieces represents a very special recording for me, different to these, the House of Stone and Light, but vocally as well. I think I'm singing from a very real, rich place. So I can't really say one section. I can see threes. I can see this was a playing the bass for the first time, doing a record with Robbie Robertson and Earth, Wind & Fire, and now sitting at a piano and saying, I'm just going to write and sing a song a day. And that's how I wrote Fugitive Pieces. A song had to be recorded the same day. I didn't write down the lyrics. I sang from anguish and what I could remember of my childhood in England, council estates. And I was brave enough to be able to do that then. You know, I was talking to my manager about this, as I couldn't have done Fugitive Pieces when I was 19 and 21. I had done Dancing in Heaven. So, you know, it's a rainbow, and those I see it in parts of three, like a clock, and I still feel like the last thing I did, Fugitive Pieces, represents a major thing for me.
Awesome. Well, I thank you for your time, and this is
great, Carl. I enjoyed it as well. It was great, fantastic.
Yeah.
You gonna get on that drum kit now and play?
No. No, I gotta get my hat, and I gotta get the outfit on.
And I tell you, mate, the way you play the drums on those tracks, it was thrilling to see. And you might want to know that Brian Fairweather, the bloke who's been with me all the years and was with me on a tour and recorded House of Stone and Light, he wrote to me and he said, that guy's nailed it. He's really got a feel for this. So you need to know that. And he's a bit of a, he's into the real groove of those tracks because he played it live with me for those years. So a lot of the players that were involved, even Neil Taylor, who was Jimmy Copley's best friend, he said, shit, he's pretty fucking damn good. You can take the effort.
I think, oh, please, Adam, it's fine. But thank you.
All right, my friend, and keep doing all the right stuff, all right, mate?
Okay, we'll talk soon. Thank you.
See you, pal. Bye-bye. Okay.